Good morning, Happy New Year, and welcome to the first meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee for 2022. Apologies this morning have been received from Faisal Chowdhury, MSP. I would also like to welcome back Natalie Dawn, MSP, who our deputy convener, who returns after a period of maternity leave. Very pleased to have you back, Natalie. And I'd also like to thank Evelyn Tweed, MSP, for her significant contribution to our work as her substitute in that time. Thank you very much indeed, Evelyn. Our first item of business today is a decision to take item four in private. Are we all agreed? We are indeed agreed. Thank you very much indeed, colleagues. The next item on the agenda is an evidence session with the on the Scottish Government's budget 22-23, which was published on the 9th of December. We focused our pre-budget work on meeting the child poverty targets and also received a response to our pre-budget letter on the 9th of December. So I welcome to the meeting Shona Robison, MSP, Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, Housing and Local Government. Joining the Cabinet Secretary, we have Shona Lang, Director for Housing and Social Justice, and Kevin Stevens, Head of Strategic and Programme Finance at the Scottish Government. Welcome to you all this morning. Thank you for joining us. I'd like to invite the Cabinet Secretary to make an opening statement, please.
Thanks very much, Convener, and a happy New Year to everyone. Thank you for the invitation to the committee today, supported by Shirley Lang and Kevin Stevens. As you'll be aware, this is another challenging budget, perhaps the most fiscally challenging to date, but one where we've had to make choices and one where we are proud that we have chosen to back our national mission to tackle child poverty and to strengthen support available for families during the cost of living crisis. We've committed almost £200 million to support the doubling of the Scottish Child Payment to £20 from April 2022, immediately supporting 111,000 children under the age of six. We're committed to rolling out the Scottish Child Payment fully to under 16s by the end of 2022, backed by an investment of £197 million. In the meantime, we'll continue to meet the costs of delivering bridging payments worth £520 in 2022 to around 150,000 children of school age. And this investment underlines our commitment to delivering on our national mission. And of course, we'll publish our next 4-year Tackling Child Poverty Delivery Plan by the end of March. And this will outline the cross-government action to put Scotland on a critical path to the targets set. The Scottish Child Payment forms part of the £4 billion that we are committing in social security and welfare payments, which will go directly to over 1 million people in Scotland. And this is money that will help low-income families with their living costs, support older people to heat their homes in winter, and will enable disabled people to live full and independent lives. This summer, we'll introduce adult disability payment, which will deliver approximately £1.95 billion of support for working age disabled people. And this brand new benefit will provide disabled people with a fundamentally different experience when applying for and receiving the support that they're entitled to. And I'm delighted to confirm the regulations for adult disability payment have been laid before Parliament, marking a significant milestone in the devolution of disability benefits. Convener, we're investing £530 million to deliver the devolved social security system in Scotland in 2022-23, ensuring a simplified, compassionate system that will treat everyone with dignity, fairness and respect and provide people with an improved experience. And this winter, we'll launch the low income winter heating assistance with a guaranteed annual payment of £50, which will benefit around 400,000 low-income households who are currently eligible for cold weather payments through an investment of £21 million. We're also investing £41 million, including local authority administration and the Scottish Welfare Fund, to provide essential help to the most vulnerable people in our communities. And this budget also recognises the important role that carers play in supporting those with disabilities or long-term conditions, with a further £315 million of funding for carers allowance and £42 million for carers allowance supplement. Within this budget, we're also making available £831 million for affordable housing, progressing our commitment to deliver 110,000 affordable energy efficient homes across the next decade, of which at least 70% will be available for social rent and 10% will be in our remote rural and island communities. We're making a further £10 million available for our Ending Home Together Fund, and this continues our investment of £100 million for transformation funding between 2018-19 and 2025-26. And it supports the commitment we made in Programme for Government to continue to invest over £100 million to support frontline services and focus on prevention of violence against women and girls from school onward over the next 3 years. This figure includes the enhanced Delivering Equally Safe Fund, which we have increased by £12 million to £38 million, providing over £28 million to support frontline services and £2 million for prevention over the next 2 years. Convener, in conclusion, this is very much a budget of choices and indeed a transitional budget, one where we've sought to support our three strategic priorities of child poverty, climate challenge and COVID economic recovery, while progressing our resource spending review for the longer term that will start underway soon. So I thank the committee for its pre-budget scrutiny and I look forward to your questions.
Thank you very much indeed, Cabinet Secretary. Very much appreciate that introduction, and I'm hoping that colleagues who haven't already indicated where they would like to ask a question can do so by typing R into the chat function as normal, or sending me a message if they have a supplementary that they would like to ask. Before I turn to colleagues in turn, I've got a few questions that I would like to raise. First of all, Cabinet Secretary, obviously we very much welcome the doubling of the Scottish Child Payment. It was called for by the committee in our pre-budget work. It will go a long way to reaching our child poverty targets. It was also very much welcomed by stakeholders, and that this doubling will happen when Scottish Child Payment is fully rolled out to children up to 16 in December. I am concerned, however, by the minutes from the Joint Ministerial Working Group, where UK ministers appeared to suggest that they may not be able to meet the timetable for that delivery. That is of great concern. Can you please confirm whether you feel the rollout and the doubling will still be deliverable by December, please?
Well, thanks very much, Convener. Let me just respond to that in a little bit of detail, because it is an important point. So, yes, I am confident, but it will take both governments to help deliver that, and I'll go on to say a little bit about why that's important. So, the Minister for Social Security and Local Government, Ben McPherson, wrote to the Minister, Chloe Smith, on the 5th of January, stressing the Scottish Government's commitment to rolling out the Scottish Child Payment to under-16s by the end of 2022. And he outlined the commitment of both governments, the joint commitment and ongoing joint programme of work, stressing the risks involved in the DWP's approach and seeking further assurances around timescales. The Scottish Government made the Department of Work and Pensions aware of our Scottish Child Payment delivery intentions back in July 2019, following the finalisation of an impacting paper. So there's been quite a bit of time, obviously, of notice to the DWP that this was our intention. There have been ongoing negotiations between the Scottish Government and the DWP trying to solve the data issues, and a joint delivery plan, I'm pleased to say, is now in place. The DWP's project documentation from August 2019 includes a list of the high-level data requirements the Scottish Government requires, plus assumptions and risks. In addition to the normal project management processes, the Scottish Government and DWP senior officials have committed to a series of additional assessments of progress against intended delivery at pre-agreed junctures from January to March. And that's important, because if it becomes clear at one of these critical checkpoints that there's a risk to successful delivery, then a joint assessment will be undertaken and action taken to mitigate the risk. There have been, I'm sure as you're aware, ongoing negotiations between the Scottish Government and the DWP trying to resolve the data issues. I think all I would say about that is that the Scottish Government's preferred solution hadn't been agreed, and therefore we had to agree quite reluctantly to the DWP's preferred solution, which does carry a higher risk. And that's the reason that the Scottish Government sought a letter of comfort from the DWP acknowledging the above to be the case. Our preference has consistently been to extend the existing systems that we have in place for the Scottish Child Payments, but the DWP's position is that it should be built on the DWP's new strategic solution. So it does carry a higher degree of risk, but we do have those mechanisms in place to monitor that, and I'm sure that's something that we could keep the committee appraised of in terms of the progress being made around the resolution of these data solutions. In blunt, convener, we can't do this without the data from the DWP. That is a critical part of being able to roll out the Scottish Child Payment by the end of this year. So we have that has to happen, and I would be happy from our end to keep the committee appraised of progress.
I thank you for that, Cabinet Secretary. I think colleagues in the committee would share my concern in that area as well, and I think it would be helpful, not least because I'm hopeful that we will have a UK Government Minister coming before the committee soon, if we could have sight of the correspondence that's been going back and forth between the two governments. I hope that's something that you can agree to.
Yeah, I'm happy to share that correspondence. I mean, there's nothing to hide here, is what I've just explained. And you know, we want to be as absolutely transparent around this and to keep the committee updated. Happy to share the correspondence, and I'm sure that, you know, when you have the DWP minister in front of you, you'll be able to ask her some similar questions around this as well.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Turn now to questions from colleagues, starting with Pam Duncan Glancy, please, followed by Marie McNair.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the committee, the clerks and to the Cabinet Secretary. Thank you for joining us this morning, and thank you for setting out your vision and also the budget itself. As it stands, only one in four children will benefit from the doubling of the Scottish Child Payment. Now, as you know, we support the doubling of the Scottish Child Payment. I think most of Parliament does. We think it also needs to be doubled again to meet the targets. But as it stands, only one in four children are going to get that doubling, because the higher rate only applies to children under the age of five, for some of the reason you've just described. However, it still means only one in four are going to get it. That leaves hundreds of thousands of children on the Scottish Child Payment bridging payments. That's 170,000 people will be left without the doubling of the payment as well. And 125,000 children don't access those bridging payments at all. So can the Cabinet Secretary tell us whether or not the government will double the bridging payments, so that those families who get the bridging payments will also get £20 a week? And also, can the Cabinet Secretary tell us a little bit more about some of the complexities with the data that she's just described?
Cabinet Secretary.
Let me first just reiterate what I said in my opening remarks, that you know, we have had a budget of choices where we have put a huge amount of money above and beyond the block grant monies received for Social Security. And I can go into that, I'm sure, in more detail during the course of this session. But the Scottish Fiscal Commission itself has recognised that actually the Scottish Government is putting a huge amount of money beyond that of the block grant into Social Security. So that, I think, needs to be recognised and forms the kind of the context, the choices that we have then had to make. And we have made, as Pam Duncan Glancy has said, the commitment to double the Scottish Child Payment to £20 from April 2022, immediately benefiting 111,000 children under the age of six. We made clear when we announced the introduction of this benefit that it will be extended to under 16s by the end of 2022, subject, as I've just been outlining in the previous answer, to the receipt of the necessary data from the DWP, at which point more than 400,000 children will be eligible for the £20 payment. And as Pam Duncan-Glancy mentioned, in advance of that, we're supporting as many school-aged children and young people as possible through our bridging payments worth £520 in 2022. And this was a response which was very innovative to make use of the data that local authorities have in delivering immediate support to around 150,000 children. The Scottish Child Payment remains the best way to provide the support to low-income families they need, and that's why we've acted to double the payment from April, and that's why we will move as quickly as we can to roll it out by the end of the year. And it is estimated that 60% of children in poverty live in a household with a child under the age of six. So this will target many families who are suffering from poverty, and it will benefit, and they will be the ones who will benefit from the doubling from April 2022. The Programme for Government committed to by the end of the parliamentary term the delivery of the increased value payment, and of course that PFG commitment is now going to be accelerated by 4 years, and I hope that's something that members will welcome. So we are going as far as we can, as fast as we can, within the resources that we have. In relation to Pam Duncan-Glancy's second point, I mean, I've laid out in some detail some of the data issues that are at play here. I've tried to be as clear and transparent as I can that, you know, we did put forward our preferred data solution. That was a very protracted negotiation, and the upshot is that we have had to, as I said, reluctantly agree to using the DWP's system, their new strategic solution. And it is a bit higher risk because it's the DWP has yet to build and test this new strategic solution, and we've not yet received the full design specification. So that does mean that the Scottish Child Payment team are having to start their development at risk based on a set of assumptions, with the acceptance that some rework is likely to be required once the full design specification has been shared with us. Having said that, as I said in my answer to the convener, there is now a structure around monitoring progress here, with some trigger points of if there are concerns, ministerial involvement will happen very quickly. Again, you're very, very happy to keep the committee informed. From our side, we are absolutely determined to get the rollout commitment happening by the end of the year. But as I also said to the convener, we absolutely require the data from the DWP in order to do that. So it's a joint two government responsibility here, and it's important that every effort is made to make sure those time scales are met.
Can I just have a short follow-up, convener? I heard the Cabinet Secretary's response, but the Cabinet Secretary will be aware that the Scottish Labour Party has written to her to suggest ways that you could reach some of those three quarters of children who are not accessing the doubling of the Scottish Child Payment. So it'd be helpful to hear either now or in the future as to why those suggestions wouldn't work. I'd also, I'm not sure if I heard there that the bridging payments will be doubled, so it'd be really good if I could get an answer on whether the bridging payments will be doubled. And then lastly, on a slightly different approach, the government, you have set out that this is a budget of priorities. And it is unfortunate, therefore, that parental employability support for some priority groups, specifically young parents and disabled people, has been reduced to £0. So can the Cabinet Secretary elaborate on the reasoning for this, given calls by organisations like the Joseph Renkey Foundation to target spending on measures to reduce child poverty for those groups?
Cabinet Secretary.
So, as I've set out, we have focused our doubling of the Scottish Child Payment April to those children under the age of six, where we know that that's 60% of households living in poverty, so it will have the biggest impact. We are determined to meet the timeframes of doubling Scottish Child Payments to everyone by the end of the year. The bridging payments are that. They're a bridging payment to help families in the meantime, and the resources that we have put into Social Security go well and above beyond the block grant. But we are within a fixed budget, and we've had to make those difficult choices in order to put money where it is going to be most effective. And I've laid out why that is and the choices that we have made. In terms of the Labour Party's contributions and ideas for the budget, of course, they will all be considered in the round by myself, by Kate Forbes and other Cabinet Secretaries. We're always looking for good ideas, but you know, we have to make sure that they are affordable within a fixed budget with all of the pressures that are there with the reduction in the settlement from the UK government. When you look at the COVID monies that have been removed, it is a tough settlement. And within that, as the Scottish Fiscal Commission has made the point, we are putting a huge amount of money projected to increase into social security and supporting low-income families beyond, well beyond that those block grants, what is contained within the block grant. Pam Duncan-Glancy talked about parental employability support, and I should just say, obviously we have the Child Poverty Delivery Plan, which we will bring forward in March, that will look across government, because as other organisations like Joseph Rowntree Foundation have said, although Social Security, yes, needs to do the heavy lifting, you can't tackle poverty and child poverty just through Social Security alone. So you have to look at other mechanisms, and we have been looking at other mechanisms across the whole of government. On parental employability, we've committed a £50 million of further investment for the Parental Employability Support Fund across 2022-24, with £5.8 million being available this year ahead of the wider investment in employability and skills, including continued investment in both No One Left Behind and Fair Start Scotland. And you know, we are aware that due to the impact of the pandemic on local authority operations, including parental engagement and employability support, there have been some delays in the rollout of the Parental Employability Support Fund. So we have been supporting parental employability. In addition to that, we are also committing the first £50 million of the £500 million whole family wellbeing funding to be invested across this parliamentary term. And that, again, the priority for that will be holistic whole family support. So I think you have to look at the round of the investment that will be made. And when we bring forward the Child Poverty Delivery Plan, you'll be able to see those investments across the whole of government. And that's before we include things like early learning and childcare and the support for families. So all of that will help to impact and to help us get towards those child poverty targets.
Unless Pam Duncan-Glancy has a further follow-up, I will move to Marie McNair, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary, and Happy New Year. Thank you for taking your time to come along to the committee this morning. It's clear there's always pressures on the Scottish security budget. How much of the Scottish Government budget goes towards mitigating UK Government cuts on welfare?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, certainly there are pressures on the Scottish Government budget, and you know, difficult choices have to be made. We are continuing to mitigate the UK government decisions on an ongoing basis. That does mean that there is less money to go elsewhere, and that is a challenge. I think as we, you know, if you take the bedroom tax, for example, so we have £80 million going into DHPs, into discretionary housing payments. It would be much better if the bedroom tax had been scrapped, and then that £80 million that we're having to put into discretionary housing payments could be spent on other areas of spend and other priorities. So these are difficult choices. We can't mitigate everything. It's just not possible to do that. Therefore, we will continue to do what we can support those in low-income households as best we can. Certainly that is something that we will continue to do.
Marie McNair.
Thank you for that response. Compared to PIP, the cost of our adult disability payment will be higher in the Scottish Fiscal Commission when they gave evidence that the last committee suggested it may be due to a more compassionate and dignified approach to claimants, leading to an increase in take-up. Do you share this assessment and do you agree with me it's something we should welcome?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yeah, I do agree with that. I think it's clear that the Scottish Fiscal Commission is essentially projecting that because of the difference in approach to adult disability payment, that more people will apply. The largest component of the divergence is the forecast on disability adult disability payment, where I think improvements to application, review and appeals processes, you know, will remove barriers to applying and are expected to result in more successful applications. And they estimate overall additional spending of £37 million in 2022-23, rising to £527 million in 2026-27. And I think these costs represent the additional investment that we're making as a result of our approach to disability benefits. And you know, they don't receive any funding from block grant adjustments, but it's the right thing to do. And we believe it will look and feel a lot different for people who are on the disability benefits than it does at the moment.
Before I bring in Jeremy Balfour, Marie McNair, do you have a further question?
Yes, I do, convener, thank you. Part of a more humane approach includes the ending the use of demoralising private sector assessments. And a more generous approach to terminal illness claims. Have you made any assessment on the financial impact of these very welcome approaches to making decisions on claims on ADP?
I think it's in the same area that I've just said. You know that basically, I think because of the different assessment processes that the assessment criteria, the Scottish assessment criteria has been widely welcomed. In fact, I think it was put forward to the committee, the Work and Pensions Committee at Westminster, that the Scottish assessment criteria has been suggested to them as a good model to look at. And I think that shows that it will be a very, very different experience, and that in turn is likely to lead to, I think, more people perhaps claiming those benefits who might have been put off. Obviously, people still need to meet the criteria, but I think the look and feel of the benefit and the way that Social Security Scotland will operate will inevitably lead to more people applying. And I think that's why the Scottish Fiscal Commission have made the assessment that they've made.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. And Marie McNair.
Convener, with your indulgence, one further question, if that's okay.
Okay.
Just with the increase in ADP take-up, we'll also see additional costs from the associated take-up of carers' allowance and supplement. Is there still no movement at UK level in changing the level of carers' allowance?
No, not that we are aware of, and of course we would always encourage the UK government to do that. We are doing what we can to support carers, and you know, happy to go into that in a bit more detail at some point during the session. But we are doing what we can to support carers, and we continue in relation to Marie McNair's earlier point, actually. Around the mitigation, the Scottish Government has invested in this last financial year £114 million to directly mitigate the impact of UK Government policies through, I mentioned the discretionary housing payments, but also the Scottish Welfare fund, and that investment is part of £367 million that's been invested over and above the block grant adjustment funding received from the UK government to deliver financial support through Social Security. So, you know, we continue to do what we can, but we can't mitigate everything. And the UK government, whether it's on carers or other benefits, really needs to step up to the plate, because otherwise we are trying to do what we can to mitigate, but we can't mitigate everything.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. And thank you, Marie McNair. Jeremy Balfour, please.
Thank you, Camilla, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary, and Happy New Year to you. Just two or three questions, if I can, on the adult disability payment. Firstly, there seems to be a funding gap of around about £750 million that will be building up in the Social Security budget over this term of Parliament. What work are you doing in regard to that, future-proofing, and how do you see these payments being made by Scottish Government?
Cabinet Secretary.
So the Scottish Fiscal Commission acknowledged that there's a lot of uncertainty over the longer term trends that could impact on the overall fiscal position, and their forecast includes several benefits that have not yet launched using assumptions that will only be confirmed when outturn data becomes available. And that the forthcoming resource spending review, in answer to Jeremy Balfour's final point, will allow us to take spending forecasts into account to determine funding requirements as we target public spending to where it delivers greatest benefits. I guess I would make the point that we are making a significant investment, which is investment in people. And the money that we are investing in ADP and other benefits are about supporting low-income households. It is about supporting people and helping people to have a better quality of life. So, we are taking the steps that we need through the resource spending review, but we certainly see that investment as really, really important investment and making improvements to the application review and appeals process and removing barriers, I think is something that would be welcomed across the Parliament, and the experience that people will have of receiving adult disability payment will be very different from perhaps the experiences they've had on previous benefits before.
Jeremy Balfour.
Yeah, I'm not quite sure I got an answer there in regard to actually how that's going to be paid for, but perhaps that's something we can turn to in the next meeting. I'm just wondering, just on a kind of a small but important bit, at the moment, those who are on PIP and DLA receive a £10 Christmas payment, extra payment from DWP. Will that be included in the new adult disability payment by Scottish Government? And if so, how much will that cost? And will that be funded by the Barnett formula, or will that be extra money that the Scottish Government have to find?
Well, I might bring Kevin in just on the specific about the extra Christmas payment, but if I can go back to the point about the how this will be paid for. And I said to Jeremy Balfour that we will be looking at all of the cost pressures within the spending review process. That is where we are able to look across the longer period of time to the pressures that will come into the budget, including Social Security, and that spending review will be where we are able to project and make adjustments in terms of the budgets going forward. So that is the mechanism to be able to ensure that the funding is there that requires to be. So maybe if I could ask Kevin, I don't know if he's able to answer the extra Christmas payment question, and if not, we will write back to the Kevin's.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. So the answer would be that to the extent that any additional payments are paid to people in England and Wales, that would be in the block grant adjustment, and that would flow through therefore to Scotland, and that money would be available for use by the Scottish Government as part of ADP. So it's a straightforward answer that relates to how the block grant adjustments operate. Thank you,
Jeremy Balfour.
That's helpful. So I presume, in light of that, we can presume that Scottish Government will pay this extra £10 in December this year. The final question is on this section, convener, is around those who are present on DLA who haven't been moved across to PIP. We took evidence from a number of groups which have showed that because of the different criteria, there may well be people who are on DLA who move across in the summer to PIP will lose their benefit or will lose part of their benefit. Will the Scottish Government mitigate this in any way, or what work are you doing to let those in that situation be aware that there may be a change in regard to the amount of money that they're going to receive because I'm offering you adult disability payment?
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary, before I bring in Emma Roddick.
Okay, yeah, I'm certainly not aware that, you know, there is a cohort of people who would lose any benefit. But again, I might bring Kevin in on that. But certainly I'm happy to write back to the committee in more detail on that. I mean, if anything, the criteria of ADP and people moving across is likely to... as I've laid out in my previous answers, if anything, it would be more likely people would be able to remain and be less likely to lose their entitlement. So I'm not quite sure where that has come from, but happy to look into that. I don't know whether Kevin has anything to add on the specifics of that.
No, I don't have anything to add on the specifics, Cabinet Secretary, no.
Okay, well, I'm happy to write to the committee with more information on the specific question.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. I'd now like to bring in Emma Roddick, please.
Thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, I was looking at the details around ADP and wondered if you could give us some more information on what happens if the UK government changes the rules and there is less money available through the fiscal framework?
So this is always this is always a concern because of the hybrid system and the any reduction of benefit spend by the UK government will have a direct impact on the spend available here in Scotland. That has always been the case, and it is one of the concerns and difficulties of this hybrid system. So you'll be aware, Emma Roddick will be aware, no doubt, of the Green Paper that has been produced. You know, there could well be a divergence of policy north and south of the border around benefits, disability benefits, and at the moment we don't know what that would mean in terms of the quantum that would be spent by the Department of Work and Pensions. If that increased, then clearly there would be a positive benefit to the Scottish budget, but if it decreased, then there would be a reduction, and that would be extremely difficult given that we have already gone above and beyond the money from the block grant, and we've put additional Scottish Government money into Social Security. If that block grant was then to be reduced, that would clearly make our situation very, very difficult. So that is one of the challenges with the current system, and one which is a big concern.
Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Convener. So I'm hearing from the Cabinet Secretary, obviously this is one of the failings of having a hybrid social security system. Does she think that this highlights the failure of the devolution settlement overall and ultimately the need for more powers in Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Emma Roddick won't get any argument from me around that. Clearly, it would be much easier if we had the entire Social Security for Scotland across all benefits devolved. It would be simple and straightforward compared to the hybrid system we have. And it would also allow us to join the dots far more across all of those benefits. So, for example, on ADP, one of the issues around negotiation around the future with the review of ADP is around the impact on passported benefits. And that will require an agreement with the UK government to make sure that if any future changes are made to ADP, that it doesn't impact on passported benefits. How much simpler it would be if we had all of those benefits under Scottish Government control, and therefore the direction of travel would be decisions that could be made here in Scotland that are in terms of best meeting the needs of the population here.
Thanks, Cabinet Secretary. Before I bring Pam Duncan-Glancy back in, on the issue around potential changes to UK disability benefits, and you've mentioned the Green Paper there and the potential challenges that that could pose regarding passporting, if there are changes to Scottish benefits, what discussions have you had with UK ministers raising concerns that you've just highlighted there around the Green Paper and potential merging, for instance, of assessment processes between Universal Credit and PIP? And also whether or not, in principle, the UK government will agree to ADP diverging and still being a passporting benefit.
Yeah, so we've raised it at the meetings we've had with the previous minister and with the current minister, and Ben McPherson, Minister for Social Security, has also raised these issues. We have also asked and flagged with them that when we get to the review of ADP, and clearly we've agreed that the mobility descriptor element, the mobility element of the review, will start earlier than the wider review of ADP, and it's really important that we get agreement with the DWP at some point that the changes that we may wish to make at some point are not going to impact on passported benefits, and we've put those markers down, and we said that we will need, you know, we want to have further discussions with them. The DWP have, I think, recognised that, have, at this stage we don't have any agreement around passported benefits, but we have, I think, flagged it clearly as an issue that we will have to have much further, more detailed discussions about.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Pam Duncan-Glancy, before I bring in Marie McNair again.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Cabinet Secretary, for your answers so far. I think that people will, I have to say, though, find it quite frustrating that we are, again, still sending 90% of the Social Security budget back to the DWP to administer. And so it's a bit, I think it's quite unfair to say that it would just be simpler and better if we were doing it here ourselves, because I'm not sure that really is the case. And on the point about unpaid carers allowance, and obviously the rate for carers allowance, you know that my own party think that the carers allowance needs wholly reformed. But that's why I think we need to get moving on doing these things in Scotland for unpaid carers and disabled people. And Bill Scott gave evidence to this committee a few weeks ago where he said that had the disabled people and unpaid carers who were asked about their opinion on what was a priority known, that safe and secure would mean that there'd be no significant change to the eligibility for it or the amount of those payments until at least 2025, possibly 26, which would be nearly 10 years after they were asked the question. They may indeed have prioritised something else. Anyway, the question that I specifically have around some of this, I have one on Carers Alliance and one on PIP, if that's okay. When the Carers Alliance supplement bill came through the committee, carers told us how important it was that the Carers Alliance supplement had been doubled and how important it is that that happens again in the future. And the minister, when he attended, said that we didn't need to write it into legislation that it would be doubled again until you had looked at carers' assistance for unpaid carers' assistance, but that in fact there would be regulation there and that would allow the government to double this payment through regulation if it was the will of the parliament. But we've not seen an indication of this in the budget. So does that mean the government's tied its own hands on this, and can carers expect to get a double payment of the carers' allowance supplement again this year?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'll come on to that in a second. I mean, let me just address the point about administration costs. I mean, Pam Duncan-Glancy is correct to say that some of the administration of benefits is still handled by the DWP, but it's the policy decisions that we make here in Scotland. So, and we've made some policy decisions that have been really, really important. So Scottish Child Payment, brand new benefits supporting families. We are making major changes to the disability benefits in terms of the look and feel of those. We are bringing in additional support. I'll come on to carers in a second. And of course, we're bringing in new supports like the low income winter heating assistance. So the policy decisions and therefore the money that goes into people's pockets here in Scotland is the important part. And even if the administration of those is, you know, some of which is still with the DWP and will transfer in time, it's the policy choices that we've made that are the most important. In terms of carers, certainly, first of all, we recognise very much that the pandemic has identified a need for greater flexibility in how we support carers. And the government chose to pay a coronavirus carers allowance supplement in 2020. And we obviously paid that again in 2021. And we did that, of course, from a fixed budget, as I've said during this session already. The additional £40 million invested in the two coronavirus carers allowance supplements this year and last is all from the Scottish Government budget. So we've had to make those choices. And while Pam Duncan-Glancy has noted that there's no initial allocation being made for a further payment in 2022-23, we will keep this position under review as part of the ongoing budget process. And importantly, we'll take into consideration the circumstances of carers and the financial constraints that we have need to be balanced, and also where we are in the process of recovering from the pandemic. So, you know, I guess I would just make this point, whether it's on additional support for carers or more support in terms of the Scottish Child Payment or more support for local government, I mean, you cannot do everything on a fixed budget. You have to make choices. And if more money is to go to Scottish Child Payment or more money above what we've already allocated is to go to carers, then it has to come from somewhere. And I'm happy to continue discussions if Pam Duncan-Glancy or others want to come forward and suggest where that money should come from, then, you know, happy to have those discussions. But, you know, we have tried to allocate where we can to support carers. And I could just finally say on unpaid carers, today, in recognition of the needs of unpaid carers, we're announcing an additional £4 million to help organisations working with unpaid carers to put expanded services in place this winter, so in the here and now, because we recognise that they're under pressure and doing an incredible job, and that's going to help local carer centres across Scotland to expand their vital support for carers. It's going to support young carers, it's going to expand the family fund support for breaks, and it will provide money for wellbeing support and services. So, you know, we do recognise the needs of carers, and we're putting money into supporting them in the here and now, as well as the budget that's coming.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Pat Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary, and thank you, Convener. On the carers allowance and the support for unpaid carers, I hear that, but unpaid carers have also consistently said that money through those routes and also the additional support for respite isn't actually cutting it for them. 82% of carers have had no access to respite recently. 73% of children and young people are still caring for a parent and have been unable to access respite support. And in 2019, which is before the pandemic, less than a third of the carers said their need for a break was considered. So it is about putting money in people's pockets, and the doubling of the carers allowance supplement is something that the Minister said when we asked him in committee about this, said that we shouldn't worry, that they felt that it was needed again, that we shouldn't worry that the regulatory powers were there to do it. So I do hope that the government will look again at that. And as COVID cases rise again, I think there will be undoubtedly much, much more pressure placed on unpaid carers. On adult disability payment, the Cabinet Secretary is quite right when it comes to the point about policy, and it is policy that people want the government to change, not just administration. However, it's actually largely the policy around eligibility and adequacy of those payments are the two areas that there is most problem. And it's that part of it that they are begging the government to do something about. And in the then First Minister at the time, when people who were getting enhanced mobility support were dropped onto PIP, the First Minister at the time said, when they said people who get enhanced mobility support would lose up £3,000 a year. Important although that money is, let's remember that for people in those circumstances, that loss could take away more than pounds and pence. It could take away their very independence. And so the now First Minister, saying that then, recognised that. So do you think that the government in Scotland is making the policy changes that it needs to add the disability payment to reflect the criticisms that the First Minister made then of personal independence payment? And have you used your powers fully to create a fairer system as disability benefits become fully devolved?
Cabinet Secretary.
So, well, let me try and be as brief as possible around what is a very complex issue and just say some key things. So, firstly, the safe and secure transfer of people on benefits where they rely on the money to adult disability payment is really, really critical. And the committee is well aware of this. They're well aware of the view of SCOS and DeepBag as well, in terms of the need to make sure that people's payments are not jeopardised in any way. So that's the first thing. The second thing, though, is that there will be a lot of changes in terms of the way people are treated, the way they experience the system, and the look and feel. The Scottish assessment criteria has been widely welcomed. And as I mentioned earlier, the Westminster Committee has been given that by third sector organisation as a template for them to look at in terms of assessment criteria. And given the Scottish Fiscal Commission's projections of the increase in expenditure around adult disability payment, which suggests that more people will apply and more people will get the benefit, suggests that that again will be a major improvement and an area that where more people will get the support that they require than they are at the moment. In recognition of some of the issues that Pam Duncan-Glancy has raised, we've been clear right from the start that there is a need to review the adult disability payment, and that has been scheduled in for a year after the safe and secure transfer, but also that the mobility descriptor element, the mobility element of ADP would be, if you like, turbocharged as part of the review, and that will start this year. But as Pam Duncan-Glancy also recognises, as I know the committee do, that the complexity of this also involves the DWP. So any changes that we propose to make after that review and full involvement of stakeholders, and of course, as you would expect, then we need to make sure that the DWP are not going to remove people's passported benefits, because the agreement with the DWP at the moment is on a like-for-like benefit. So although all the improvements will be made, it has to have an equivalence to be able to maintain those passporting benefits until we get agreement from the DWP. So, you know, any persuasion that can be put to the DWP, and I know if you have the minister in front of you from the DWP, that will be some really, really important questions for them, because we need to make sure that we have the scope to be able to make the changes that we would want to make. So, you know, I've tried to condense what is a really, really complex area into some of the key issues that really need to be considered here.
Pam Duncan-Glancy, would you like to come back in before I bring Marie McNair in?
Yes, I would, with your indulgence, please, convener. Thank you. I understand that there are complexities involved, and I should declare an interest as someone who receives personal independence payment. I know the importance of the safe and secure transfer. I don't want the money to drop off and the van, my mobility van, not to be there. So I get the importance of that. But had you asked disabled people now and unpaid carers now what was most important, I think they would also say you need to consider eligibility and adequacy. And I think the Cabinet Secretary characterised earlier that the 90% funding that was going back to the DWP was on administration, and that you were dealing with policy, and that we were dealing with policy here in Scotland. But actually, what's just been described, I think, is very much that in Scotland we're changing the administrative process, and those changes are, for what I can tell, look to be positive. But we're still not changing any of the policy substantially. So, given the complexities that the cabinet secretary has just set out, and that we understand exist, and the cabinet secretary confirmed that the review can begin before the safe and secure transfer on the policy work, not necessarily on the building work of Social Security Scotland to make those payments, but on the policy work that the Social Security team within the Scottish Government are doing, so that there is plenty of time and we don't face a situation after the rollout of the safe and secure transition that we might, similar to that which we currently might be facing in terms of the rollout of the Scottish Child Payment, where yet again we could face a delay because we haven't been prepared.
Cabinet Secretary. Well,
can I just say on that last point, we are prepared and we signalled to the DWP back in summer of 2019 our intention to double the Scottish Child Payment. So there's been no lack of preparation on behalf of the Scottish Government. What we have had is a lack of agreement with the DWP about the data transfer. And I explained in some detail in my initial answer to the convener about why that is, that we put forward a proposal we thought was less risky and more straightforward. The DWP have not agreed that and want to use their new system, which carries higher risk because it's a new system, and therefore that needs to be built in. So there's been no lack of preparation. And I also told the committee earlier about the review points to make sure that we are jointly responsible for making sure that that data transfer happens and that we can get the doubling of the Scottish Child Payment by the end of this year. So there's no lack of preparation on the part of the Scottish Government. Now, on the review of ADP, as I set out, the strategic review we have said should take place once there is the safe and secure transfer. However, I also said earlier that we would have an earlier part of that review kicking off, looking at the mobility descriptors, the mobility element, if you like, of the criteria, and that will start this year. So it will start more quickly in recognition, I think, of the concerns. The only point I would make is that, you know, all of this is not all within our gift. So any changes that we propose to make, we have to have the certainty that they're not going to impact on passport and benefits. And that's why, going forward, the response of the DWP to any changes that are made or proposed changes that are made is as important. And on the policy issue, I would just finally say this. If we weren't making major changes to the look and feel and scope of the criteria, the assessment criteria, I don't think the Scottish Fiscal Commission would be projecting the big increase on ADP spend that they're projecting. And they're projecting that increase for the very reason that there is likely to be improvements to the application, review and appeals processes, which mean more people will keep their benefit and more people will be likely to be entitled to it.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I bring in Marie McNair now, please.
Thank you, Convener. We recently took evidence from a range of experts on the 20-metre rule. And this evidence asserted that the 20-metre rule was introduced by Westminster Government to simply achieve cuts to the DWP budget. Would you welcome the cut being reversed at the UK level, and would this consequently have a positive impact on the Scottish Government budget if considering the 20-metre rule?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, any changes that increase funding for social security at Westminster have a positive benefit on our budget, and of course, as we talked about earlier, the reverse is also true. So I would certainly encourage, and as part perhaps of the Green Paper going forward, that the 20 metre rule would be reviewed. I think having the DWP reviewing disability benefits from a positive point of view, at the same time as we look to review ADP and ADP criteria, would be very helpful, I think, if we could then reach a common understanding and agreement that would allow people who are on reserve benefits not to have those benefits put in jeopardy. So, you know, if the direction of travel by the UK government was to be more flexible and more generous around disability benefits, then that would, of course, help the situation here in Scotland, both on the budgetary position, but also on the scope of change of criteria, I would suggest as well.
Thank you. Our briefing state that the Best Start grant and the Best Start foods are not being upgraded. Can you comment on this? And is this something that you'll keep under review?
Cabinet Secretary.
In terms of the Best Start payments and the Best Start grants, we have agreed to make sure that they are uprated going forward. I mean, first of all, the Best Start grants and the Best Start payments form an important part of the support that is given to children. And it is an important part of the overall package. We increased Best Start foods in August this year from £4.25 to £4.50, a rise exceeding the rate of inflation and providing a level of support more generous than in other parts of the UK. We're also widening eligibility for Best Start foods later in the parliamentary term. We increased Best Start grant in 2021 by 1%, which is technically double the rate of inflation. So a two-child family will now receive £1,919 in their children's early years, £1,419 more than the Sure Start maternity grant equivalent. And of course, as I've said earlier, the families receiving the Best Start grant and the Best Start foods will also benefit from the doubling of Scottish Child Payment from April, as I said earlier on. I think it's important to maybe also, we talk about big numbers and sometimes just, you know, big numbers don't always mean a lot to people. But when you take together with the Best Start grant and the Best Start foods, this together will provide a financial support package worth £8,400 by the time an eligible family's first child turns six, a commitment to, I think, the most vulnerable children that's unparalleled across the UK. And I think, you know, that kind of brings it home to what this means actually for families.
Thank you. Finally, the child winter heating assistance is increasing by 5%, and this is welcome, but it's higher than the uprating of some other benefits. Can you comment on the reason for this?
Yep. Happy to. We've chosen to increase the child winter heating assistance by 5%, which is above the rate of inflation, as, you know, we wanted to do all we can to help families of the most severely disabled children and young people cope with rising energy costs. Those are rising energy costs are clearly a big concern, a big issue for people at the moment. So, you know, that was the thinking behind that, and I think that will be important for those in that position.
Thank you.
Is that all your questions on that area?
Thank you.
Thanks, Marie. Cabinet Secretary Marie McNair there was looking at a range of social security areas, which are obviously part of anti-poverty work that the Scottish Government is endeavouring on. As a committee, we've been very keen to ensure that across government there is a commitment to tackling poverty and that poverty is looked at in all areas of government. So can you set out, in terms of the Scottish budget, how the Scottish Government is poverty-proofing in other areas alongside social security and what involvement you've had in those discussions, please?
Yeah, I mean, you make an important point, and as I alluded to earlier on, looking at the budget and then looking at the child poverty delivery plan for March, it has to be across government. It can't all be from my portfolio. And that's why all cabinet secretaries were tasked with looking within their own budgets at what more they can do to help us meet those interim targets. I think we've got a good track record. So if you look back in 2020-21, we invested £2.5 billion to support low-income households. That was an increase of £540 million on the year before, and £978 million was targeted directly at children in low-income families. And I think these estimates, including kind of key investment in support targeted at children, whether that was the winter hardship payments, the Attainment Scotland funding, the People Equity Fund, the broader low-income support such as Council Tax Reduction Scheme, which amounts to about £351 million, discretionary housing payments that I referred to earlier, the Scottish Welfare Fund. So, you know, in the round, looking at 2022-23, the Scottish budget continues significant investment along those lines to tackle poverty. So more than £3.9 billion towards benefit expenditure. We're committing £831 million towards the delivery of affordable housing. As I said, £80 million investment to discretionary housing payments. The first £50 million of the Whole Family Wellbeing Fund. The £10 million for Tackling Child Poverty Fund, £200 million for the Scottish Attainment Challenge, £70 million to continue to fund the expansion of free lunches for children in primary 4 and 5 in special schools, £22 million to provide meals during school holidays, and £65 million for employability support for those most impacted by COVID. And, of course, within the local government settlement, There is funding for mechanisms, things like the Scottish Welfare Fund and others as well. So I think in the round, quite a comprehensive package. There's always more that can be done, and, you know, keen to hear what more people think we could be doing. But that has to be within the context of a fixed budget where decisions like this have to be made. And I think we have prioritised support for low income families.
Thanks, Cabinet Secretary. Before I bring in Miles Briggs, you touched there on the potential role for local government, and I've heard Cabinet Secretary and other ministers describe the anti-poverty work as being a national mission, which I think is absolutely right. But what more can local authorities, employers, all of us across society do to support this goal of bringing down child poverty in Scotland?
Well, yeah, I mean, it's not just Scottish Government that needs to play its part. The UK Government needs to play its part as well. And we've talked about the mitigation that we've had to spend money on. So the example I used earlier on, if the UK Government would scrap the bedroom tax, we wouldn't have to spend £80 million on discretionary housing payments. That is money that could be spent elsewhere. One example. In terms of other bodies, councils are a really important partner, and we have a partnership with local government, and a key priority with local government to tackle child poverty. So a lot of the money that we're talking about in terms of the Attainment Challenge, the early learning and childcare, which again is a crucial element, is all routed through local government. And with our partners in local government, we will keep a firm focus on tackling child poverty and trying to, I guess, wrap around families. So if you take the six priority families, I think we need to get far closer to supporting families and to be working with those families around what they need to make the difference. So whether that is the support we provide through Social Security and child payment, obviously important, but also the employability programmes. Would the wraparound childcare for those families make the difference in them being able to go and secure fair work, fair paid work, and remove barriers that are there at the moment that prevent them doing so. So looking at how do we support them, and a lot of that will come through the child poverty delivery plan that we will bring forward in March. Employers, really, really important, because if we can get more employers paying the living wage and paying fair and signing up to fair work, then clearly that helps to tackle child poverty. We know that decent paid work is still the key way out of child poverty and poverty for families. So employers have a really, really big job in making sure that they pay at least the living wage. So we will explore many of these aspects as we go forward, and we've been trying to engage with employers around what more they can do, and there are some good examples of employers going the extra mile in terms of support for their employees, and we want to work with them as exemplars of what other employers could do to play their part.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I'd like to bring Miles next, followed by Jeremy Balfour, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary, and good morning to your officials as well. I wanted to ask a few questions with regards to homelessness, which you touched upon in your opening statement today. I wanted to ask specifically around rapid rehousing transition plans, which I think is the right approach, but will take significant resource to properly implement, especially here in my own city of Edinburgh. So can I ask what funding will be attached to the rapid rehousing transition plans? And will you be matching previous commitments on that?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yeah, so the rapid rehousing transition plans are critical and a critical part of the affordable housing budget going forward. I think it is really important that we tackle temporary accommodation, an issue I know that the member has raised previously. So if you take the rapid rehousing transition plans are absolutely critical in making sure that people, first of all, are moved out of temporary accommodation as quickly as possible. Temporary accommodation, I should say, does provide an important safety net for people. So it's there for a reason, but people shouldn't be in temporary accommodation any longer than they need to be, and should be moved into settled accommodation as quickly as they can be. We've committed £53.5 million for rapid rehousing. Within that, obviously Housing First is also funded to ensure that those with more complex needs are supported to move in to their own tenancies. So it's not just, as we've talked many times, about bricks and mortar, it's about the wraparound support to ensure that people are able to maintain a successful tenancy. I think we need to look at supporting particular local authorities who have had more challenges. The City of Edinburgh clearly has pressures on housing, perhaps more so than in other local authorities. We recognise that, and we are trying to work with local authorities that are under particular pressure to come up with the solutions that they need to. So local authorities have been allocated an annual share of £23.5 million for homelessness prevention and response measures, and Edinburgh's allocation of that funding is £4.4 million. So, you know, we will work with individual local authorities to try and help them overcome some of the difficulties that they are facing.
Thank you for that. Thank you, Convener. I think in your response, therefore, that this would be a commitment to at least match previous funding commitments. But, you know, I think it's important we do see better transparency and monitoring around how that's spent. But I wanted to move on to a question I'd asked you in previous committee sessions with regards to the Tackling Homelessness budget. In your letter to the committee of the 1st of October, Cabinet Secretary, you said that the £60 million was still to be allocated for this coming financial year. We've obviously got 3-4 months left. So I wondered how that had been allocated.
So we have, as I said earlier, we've got the current 5-year, 50 million Ending Homelessness Together Fund, happy to bring perhaps Shirley in to answer the detail around that, but you can be assured that the funding that we're putting into homelessness prevention will all be allocated and will be used as you would expect it to be used in terms of making sure that we don't just tackle homelessness in terms of the rapid rehousing and the housing first, but we also prevent homelessness. And part of the work this year, which will be new, is the new homelessness prevention duty, which we will be expanding the duty and requirements of that local authorities have, but we will also be expanding that to other parts of the public sector, because the best way of preventing homelessness is to get in early and early prevention, and that legislation and change will require all of the public sector to ensure that they have a duty to highlight where they think someone could potentially become homeless and then to do something about it. But perhaps if I can bring Shirley in just on the 16 million, if that's okay.
Hi there, Cabinet Secretary, thank you. I'm afraid, Ms. Briggs, I don't actually have the detail of that to hand, but I'm happy to write back to you. I'm really sorry. I can't give you a full answer right this second. I don't want to waste the committee's time by attempting to do so, but I'll come back to you on it.
Okay, that would be helpful. And I take it this money will be allocated before the end of the financial year, given we're almost there, really. In political terms, there's 4 months to go. I think it's important that finance isn't rolled over and lost for those organisations who are certainly desperately wanting to make a difference and could access it. Finally, Convener, I wanted to ask with regards to advice services. We know, and the Cabinet Secretary actually was at Local Government Committee on Tuesday when we discussed the local government settlement. There was severe concerns expressed by Martin Booth, the Director of Finance from Glasgow City Council, about where councils might need to make cuts. And one of the concerns was around advice services. Now, we've taken a lot of evidence as a committee about the importance of that advice services being protected and supplied to some of the most vulnerable people in our society. So I wondered, given the cuts which councils are expressing concerns around, how that service will be protected.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, look, first of all, on the homelessness money, no money will be lost. I mean, the money that is going to support homelessness services is guaranteed, and however it's paid and whenever it's paid, it certainly won't be lost. In terms of just a general point on the local government settlement, and Miles Briggs is obviously aware of the exchanges that we had with the local government committee. I mean, we have tried to ensure that local government gets a fair settlement within a very, very difficult fiscal financial environment, and we recognise that the partnership we have with local government is critical to delivering on many of the services and relating to the poverty. A lot of the money that I've talked about today will be routed through local government. I've mentioned a number already, whether that's discretionary housing payments, whether it's the Scottish Welfare Fund, all of which will support people who require the support. In terms of advice services, we have made additional monies available for advice services, and we would expect those services to be maintained. And we recognise the role that the local government has in ensuring that people have access to the information that they need. And that's in addition, obviously, to the work of our third sector partners in making sure people are aware of the support that is available, and also including the national campaigns that are run to make people aware. So, you know, these are discussions that we'll continue to have with local government, but the advice services are an important aspect of that.
Thanks, Cabinet Secretary. Unless Miles Briggs has a supplementary to that.
No, happy to come in later, Convener. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Miles. I'll bring in Jeremy Balfour, please.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if I can cover two areas with you, Cabinet Secretary. Firstly, just following on from Miles Briggs' questions, around new housing, you and I appeared in a BBC slot in regard to housing, particularly for those with disability, and the number of houses that have been built there. I wonder if you could tell us how much money has been allocated specifically for housing which will meet those not only with physical disabilities, but all forms of disability, and what target are you looking to set in regard to the number of houses, new houses being built, that will have that features built in?
Cabinet Secretary.
Okay, well, I'm certainly happy to write to the committee with more detail around this, but I think the overall direction of travel is obviously to make all homes barrier free, and there are standards for new housing that will help to deliver that. In terms of retrofitting and, you know, adaptations, clearly we have been supporting RSLs and local authorities to ensure that aids and adaptations are supported. The local needs assessment is important. Local authorities will also be reporting back on a regular basis to us around the levels of accessible housing within their areas. I think there is more we need to do, though, and I'm very struck by, and I think the media interview I did was on the back of a case which was quite a challenging case of someone with very complex needs, and I'm not sure that at the moment our systems provide for those who have particularly complex needs and need bespoke solutions. So, for those whose mobility kind of changes over time, then yeah, we have systems of aids and adaptations and changes that can be made to existing housing. And with new stock, obviously, there are higher standards around accessibility and being barrier free. However, there will still be people who have particular complex needs which require that bespoke solution. And I'm not sure that we really have got that quite right yet. And then one of the commitments that I've made is to, and I've asked officials to look at how we can do more in that space of helping to resolve those very, you know, complex cases and support local authorities and RSLs to do that. And I'm happy to come back to the committee with more information about that if they find that helpful.
Thank you. Jeremy Balfour.
Yeah, I mean, I'd be grateful if the Cabinet Secretary would come back to us. I mean, I wonder if you can just, I think you said in your opening statement that all new housing will be, or all new developments will be disabled, disability, open for anyone with disability. Now, clearly that can't be the case, because in that case, every new flat block would have to have a lift in it. If you're buying a flat on the top floor and you have a wheelchair, you can only access that through a lift. So I wonder if you, when you come back to us, are you looking to set a target of a specific number of houses that will be accessible to those with disabilities? And what conversations are you having with developers to say, as we have the 25% that have to be affordable, are you putting a percentage on the number of houses that have to be built, which are fully accessible to disabled, or are you leaving it to developers to make that decision?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yeah, I will come back to the committee with more detail on that. I mean, the point I'm making is that new standards are better at ensuring that for people with mobility requirements, that they better meet their needs. The Housing to 2040 is clearly a journey that is going to be over a longer time frame of meeting higher standards. I want to get to the position that Housing to 2040 sets out, that, you know, the end point and the vision at the end of that journey is that all homes should be barrier free, particularly new homes. And we are on a journey on that. It's a, you know, but I'll come back to the committee in terms of targets and you know, time frames along the way to housing to 2040 that can help add a bit of detail onto that.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Looking to bring in Pam Duncan-Glancy, unless Jeremy Balfour has a final question.
Yep, I have another area just to cover, convener. Okay. Thank you. And that is in regard to third sector funding. Kate Forbes, in her budget statement back in December, I asked a question after that, and she indicated that there would be a change, that third sector funding would not be done on a yearly basis, but on a three-year basis. And I'm just wondering if the Cabinet Secretary could update us what conversations are happening with the third sector, and is this going to be, when will this actually be implemented, and how will it be implemented?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's been a long-term aim and a call, quite rightly, by the third sector to want to move to multi-year funding, and we are keen to do that, and you know, we will be working with the third sector to make sure we can move towards that, because it does give more certainty to the third sector. Obviously, the funding to the third sector comes across the whole of government, not just from my portfolio. My portfolio just really has the kind of core third sector funding, but actually, the bulk of third sector funding comes from elsewhere across government. So it requires a cross-government agreement to move to that multi-year settlement. And again, I'm happy to you know, keep the committee appraised of the progress that we make around those multi-year funding discussions.
Jeremy Balfour.
Again, if I can just seek a bit of clarification with Cabinet Secretary, is it going to happen as of now, or are you still discussing it as a government to decide if it is going to happen?
Well, all of these things, as I've mentioned on a few occasions, we are going to be entering into the resource spending review, and that provides the opportunity and the platform to discuss all of these things. I mean, it's not just the third sector that are wanting to move to multi-year settlements, it's local government as well. And we've already, Kate Forbes has already agreed with local government that we will start those discussions around coming to a kind of multi-year, a different fiscal framework, if you like. And you know, so therefore, I think there's a parallel discussion through the resource spending review that we would want to have with the third sector to move in that direction as well.
Jeremy Balfour.
I'm done. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. Pam Duncan-Glancy, please.
Thank you, Convener. And if I could just return to the local government funding. And one of the questions I have is around the Scottish Welfare Fund. I'm quite worried, actually, about the Scottish Welfare Fund. We know that the repeat applications are being made to it, which suggests that people are living from crisis to crisis, so it's not really meeting the underlying strategic and fundamental change that it is needed in terms of people's cost of living, but also that there is a significant postcode lottery in the Scottish Welfare Fund. And also, during the pandemic, organisations have seen a much bigger increase in applications for their discretionary funds, and that's been seen when you look at the when you compare that to the applications to Scottish Welfare Funds, they haven't been applied for or delivered quite so often, and so there's something that is not quite right there. I also know that sectors like creative industry and the hospitality industry really, really need some help just now, and a number of people have saw reductions in their incomes, and they could be helped, for example, through the Scottish Welfare Funds, but almost all of this budget for this year seems to have been spent already, which is barely halfway through the year ahead. So can the Cabinet Secretary set out when the review of the Scottish Welfare Fund will start? Will it include additional money for processing things like the self-isolation support grant? Do you think that you would be able to promote the crisis grant part of that to creative and hospitality industries so that people working in them can see that there is funding available if their income has dropped? And do you think the current, or does the Cabinet Secretary think the current budget for the Scottish Welfare Fund is sufficient?
Cabinet Secretary.
Okay, well, let me try and answer those questions in turn. The Scottish Welfare Fund does provide a vital safety net for people experiencing a financial crisis or needing help. And obviously, it can't be a regular source of income for someone, but it can help in crisis situations. In 2022-23, we're going to be investing £41 million in the Scottish Welfare Fund. 45% of crisis grant applications are made by people requiring help due to their benefits or income having already been spent. And local authorities are able to carry forward any underspend from previous year's budget, which means that the total available in the current financial year is £45 million. Now, last year, over £49 million was paid out from the fund, and over 200,000 individual awards were made to low-income households. And, of course, a number of councils add to the fund. In addition, £25 million of flexible funding as part of the £41 million winter fund is available to support people experiencing financial insecurity, because we recognised this winter will be tough because of rising costs, and that therefore that £25 million of flexible funding should help local authorities to be able to meet their needs. The distribution of funds is based on the number of low income benefit recipients in each local authority and has been agreed with COSLA. So any changes obviously also need to be agreed with COSLA. In terms of the review, we committed to undertake a full independent review of the welfare fund to ensure that it does work as well as possible across the country. And it will look at issues like funding, administration, promotion, take up and accessibility. I can tell the committee that following a competitive tendering exercise, a preferred contractor has been identified to undertake independent research, and we're finalising the contract with the organisation. I'm happy to update the committee when that is done and the work begins. That's imminent, and I expect the work to start by the end of the month and the final report expected by the end of this year. A key element is about gathering the views of applicants to the fund to hear what they have to say, whether they've been successful or not successful. And a review advisory group has been established to provide oversight to the research process, and it will include membership from key organisations that you would expect. So I hope all of that helps to make sure that we do address any issues that need to be addressed in terms of improving the welfare fund.
Thank you, convener. Thank you. A short follow up on that, and then I'll move on to my final area of question, and which is around third sector budget. The Scottish Welfare Fund, as the Cabinet Secretary has set out, is not a substitute for, or certainly shouldn't be a substitute for proper strategic support and a social security system that's there for people when they need it. However, the suggestion that people, or the data shows that people are making repeated applications to this fund, which would suggest that they're moving from crisis to crisis, reflective probably of the poverty that they're in. And so it's likely that we need to do more to address the poverty they're experiencing. But also the £41 million that the Cabinet Secretary has set out, about £5 million of that is for administration, leaving approximately £35.9 million, I think, and £30 million of that has already been spent, and we're only 7 months into the year. And so I guess I'd ask again whether the Cabinet Secretary thinks that the budget is going to stretch where it needs to this year, given that a number of organisations, a number of people, particularly in the creative and hospitality industries, are going to see their incomes drop or have done in previous weeks as a result of the Omicron variant. After that, the other question I have, if it's all right, I'll just roll it in, is around the third sector. The Cabinet Secretary will be aware at the disappointment of organisations in the third sector, including Scottish Council for Voluntary Organisations, about the £800 million cut to the £800,000 cut, nearly £1 million, to the fiscal budget for the third sector, which does sit in the Cabinet Secretary's portfolio, and they've said that that will have significant impacts on the organisations that they represent's ability to do their job. They've called it a severe blow. So what does the term infrastructure costs cover? Will this translate to cuts in funding for vital community services? And does the Cabinet Secretary think the third sector is getting enough money?
Cabinet Secretary, on the welfare fund and third sector budgets.
Right. So on the welfare fund, as I tried to set out in my initial answer, the total available in the current financial year, and I guess we need to just work, we're talking about two different financial years here. So the total available in the current financial year, 2021-22, is £45 million. And although £49 million is paid out from the fund, obviously councils add into the fund. So councils top up the welfare fund. So, you know, we need to keep an eye on these things. Obviously, as I also said, you know, we've put £25 million of flexible funding as part of the £41 million winter fund to, in recognition of the demands on the fund that Pam Duncan Clancy had alluded to. You know, we keep an eye on this. We continue to work with COSLA and individual local authorities to monitor demand on the fund, and we'll continue to do that. The review is obviously going forward in order to examine issues such as funding, administration, promotion, take-up, accessibility, and obviously addressing, you know, some issues where some local authorities appear to use the fund a bit differently from others, and some have an overspend, some have an underspend. So the review will look at all of those issues. In relation to the third sector funding, in addition to what I have said already, and I would just reiterate what I said already, and that is that the third sector funding in the main comes from across the whole of government. I think SCVO itself had estimated that there was the third sector benefited from around £500 million in investment across the whole of the Scottish government. And therefore, the amount within my portfolio is a relatively small part of that. And we don't believe that there'll be any immediate impacts on infrastructure bodies that are funded through the element within my portfolio. And I think by identifying efficiencies and working across other portfolios, we don't believe an individual organisation will lose core funding in the short term. And we would want to work on the multi-year funding that I talked about earlier on over the medium to longer term.
Pam Duncan Clancy.
Thank you, convener. And just to follow up on the point about the third sector funding, SCVO highlighted in the written evidence to this committee ahead of the session that it may be perceived as a small cut to a budget, as you might have just described in terms of the budget line that the Cabinet Secretary is responsible for. However, they have noted that it will weaken support for voluntary organisations, the volunteers across Scotland, at a time of course, great uncertainty. And the intermediary bodies are really committed to supporting the government, but they won't be able to do this if this funding cut is not reversed. Could the Cabinet Secretary set out whether or not the £800,000, nearly £1 million cut, will go ahead this year?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, look, first of all, I absolutely recognise the important role of the third sector. And I just reiterate that the major funding for the third sector doesn't come from my portfolio. It's the £500 million plus is across the whole of government. We believe that this could be, in terms of the £25.8 million for next year, we believe that the adjustments can be managed through efficiencies and other portfolios supporting the third sector. We don't believe it will have the impact that Pam Duncan Clancy has alluded to. So we will work through these things. We'll work with the third sector to make sure that doesn't happen. But, you know, as I said at the beginning, this is a really, really tough budget. We need to make sure that we drive efficiencies where we can. We need to avoid duplication, and we need to make sure that every pound that is spent in the most efficient way that we can. The third sector is very efficient at spending the money that we provide, and we want to work with them to make sure that they continue to deliver what they are delivering. They're an absolute core part of the COVID recovery programme going forward, and you know, I give my commitment to supporting them to do that.
Looking to bring in Miles Briggs for the final set of questions, unless Pam Duncan-Glancy has a follow-up question.
No, I'm all good. Thank you.
Miles Briggs, please.
Thank you, Convener. I wanted to ask a specific question with regards to the impact of any council tax increases which we're likely to see. The committee's heard from a number of sessions that council tax is often one of the driving forces of pushing people into poverty and not being able to pay those bills. The year before the pandemic, we know that the amount of council tax debt increased by 25% to over £95 million. So I just wondered, Cabinet Secretary, you've outlined some of the support which is available, but what's your personal opinion on what a potential increase in council tax, given what we're seeing around energy prices, is going to have, and what additional support can be given to councils to help keep those increases as low as possible?
Cabinet Secretary.
So I think in response to Miles Briggs, I would really just reiterate what I said to him when I think he asked this at the local government committee, and that is, first of all, this is obviously for local authorities to decide their council tax level. It's not for government to tell them what they should do in relation to their council tax setting. That is for them. The second thing I would say is that obviously council tax levels are very much below those elsewhere in the UK, significantly lower. So we're starting from a lower baseline. And we have the council tax reduction scheme where people, huge numbers of people are supported with their council tax to make sure that where people are struggling and would struggle with their council tax, that they are supported through the council tax reduction scheme. I'm happy again to, you know, furnish the committee with the detail of that. But you know, that is something that is available to an extent not available elsewhere, and I guess recognises that the point that you know, that Miles Briggs makes, that you know, we need to support people who are struggling with their council tax. The £130 pandemic payment was also paid to those in receipt of council tax reduction. So I think if you take all of those together as a package, the money that I've talked about throughout this session of supporting low-income households is you know, going to be important as we face some of the rising living costs, whether that's food or fuel costs, that the package of measures and the funding that we're giving to low-income households will help to keep people's heads above water over the next few months.
Miles Briggs.
Thank you for that. The Scottish Government has previously supported a council tax freeze and provided the resources to local authorities to meet that. Now, all local authority leaders have expressed concern that they now face £371 million of cuts, and that will lead to these increases. So can I ask why, given all the pressures we're seeing on household budgets, that resource hasn't been provided to try to meet a freeze this year?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, we have try to provide local government with a fair and affordable settlement within a really, really tough financial environment and a tough settlement from the UK government. Now, out of that, we have tried to give local authorities a fair and affordable core settlement. But of course, a lot of local government resource comes from other portfolio investments, whether that's childcare, education, which the member will be aware. We feel there's no money left over, there's no money down the back of the couch, so that money has all been allocated, and we have tried to allocate money to local government, at the same time providing money for Social Security to double the Scottish Child Payment. So all of these have to be weighed up in the round. If Miles Briggs believes that more money should be given to the local government core grant, for example, then, you know, he will have to tell us where that has to come from. Should it come from Social Security, from the additional money that has been recognised by the Scottish Fiscal Commission that we're putting into Social Security? If that money was instead to go to local government, then that would be money that wouldn't be going into the pockets of people in low-income households. So these are all balanced decisions that have to be made out of a fixed budget. There's no magic money tree that can provide money that doesn't come from elsewhere. So in balancing the budget and the budget discussions that will happen, and I'm sure Miles Briggs, could be part of those budget discussions with my colleague Kate Forbes, but any movement in money has to be compensated from elsewhere. And those are the really difficult challenges that we'll face over the next few weeks. And, you know, keen to hear what other parties have to say and where they would shift money from one place to another.
Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener. And just finally, I wanted to ask, we know that during the pandemic, a significant number of our fellow Scots have become carers and taking on a carer role. And in many cases, that has been women in Scotland who have taken on those roles. So I wondered, looking at the budget as a whole, Cabinet Secretary, where you think that works for women in Scotland to try to make sure that they can realise their potential, get back into employment if that's what they want to be doing, and also to support carers who are now taking on, in many cases, caring roles which local authorities previously were supporting, but we've seen cut during the pandemic.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think the first thing to say is to acknowledge that women probably have been hardest hit during the pandemic for all of the reasons that we understand. And that's why during the pandemic we have tried to support households, because we know that that will disproportionately support women and families who are struggling. So whether that's through the pandemic support payments, the £130 pandemic support payments, whether it's through the bridging payments, the Scottish Child Payment, whether it's through all of the other supports that I've outlined during the course of this session, women will be a major beneficiary of that, particularly women with children in low income households. In terms of carers, I've laid out earlier the support, the additional support that we've given to carers over the last 2 years, and the support that we're giving to carers this year that is in the budget, and this additional support that I laid out, the unpaid carer support that I laid out earlier in terms of the additional £4 million here and now to support carers who are facing challenges, all of which, again, will disproportionately benefit women. We do recognise the burden that women have carried through the pandemic, and we want to do what we can to support them, and we believe that through the mechanisms that I've laid out previously that we've done our best to do that.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I believe that's Miles Briggs completed his set of questions, and if there are no further questions from other colleagues, it leaves me just to thank you, Cabinet Secretary, and your colleagues, Kevin Stevens and Shirley Lang, for your time this morning. It's greatly appreciated. I think we've covered a significant amount of ground across what is a very wide portfolio. So very much appreciate your time today, and no doubt we will hear from you shortly on the commitments that you've made to follow up in writing with some of the correspondence that you committed to providing, and also some of the questions that you were looking to follow up in writing. So we look forward to hearing from you on those areas. Thank you very much indeed to you all for your time. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. We now move to the third item on the agenda, where we will consider a negative SSI. Members are invited to consider the Social Security Administration and Tribunal Membership Scotland Act 2020, Commencement Number 5, and Transitional Provisions Regulations 2021. Colleagues will be aware that background to this these regulations are outlined in paper 3. Do members, any colleagues, have any comments to make in relation to these regulations? I'm not seeing anyone coming forward. Are colleagues therefore content to note the instrument? Thank you very much indeed. That then concludes the public part of this morning's meeting. Next week, the committee will take evidence from the Minister on the Child Disability Payment and Disability Assistance for Children and Young People regulations. I would now like to suspend the meeting, move to a private session, and colleagues should leave this meeting and join the private session link, which will be in your calendars. Thank you very much indeed, colleagues.